Hey everybody, Flickers of Fear time again. So this is a movie that I had been wanting to see for quite a while, and I finally got around to seeing it. This came out in 2018, and it's called Unsane. I know that when they released one of Dario Argento's movies in the US, was it Tenebrae? I can't remember which one it was now, but they, for some reason, the US cut of it had the title Unsane. This has nothing to do with that, so I just thought I'd put that out there. Again, this is kind of like, I'm not gonna spoil the ending, I'm not gonna spoil anything like that, but this movie takes some real unexpected turns, so I might like spoil some of that. So if you haven't seen the movie, it's on Amazon Prime. If you have an Amazon Prime subscription, you can watch it for free. And so go watch it and then come back and then we'll talk about it. So this was directed by Steven Soderbergh, who I've seen several of his movies. He started out with Sex, Lies, and Videotape, which was actually one of my favorite movies of the 90s. That came out in the 90s, right? Something like that. But yeah, I love that movie. He's done like a lot of indie stuff, but he also did like the Ocean's 11 movies and things of that nature. It's interesting because he seems like an interesting filmmaker because he makes financially successful, like kind of big studio stuff, but then he also kind of has like an art house type of shit too, like, you know, kind of aspect to him, like an experimental thing. Now, this movie, probably one of the first things that everybody will say about it when they review it was that this movie was shot entirely on an iPhone 7 Plus, I think. Now, I did not know that before going in. Some people, like when I watched some reviews of it later, they said that, you know, it was a little bit distracting or you could tell that it was shot on a phone. It didn't, like the aspect ratio was strange, but honestly, I didn't really notice it. So I don't know if that's just me and I'm just like not big on my like filmmaking lingo or whatever. But like I said, I didn't realize that it was shot on a phone and the weird aspect ratio didn't bother me. And so, you know, I don't know. But so basically Steven Soderbergh was like, he had the phone, he wanted to see if he could shoot an entire film on it. And I thought it came out good and he just kind of did it as an experiment. But I don't know, I've seen some reviews saying it was like, well, he didn't have to shoot it on if it doesn't have anything to do with like the theme of the movie. I don't know, I think I might disagree. I just think there's something, I don't know. There is some kind of thematic resonance, I think, the fact that I don't even know if he was thinking about it necessarily, but that he shot the whole thing on the cell phone. But we'll get into that in a little bit. So what is this movie about? Like I said, it starts out as, I guess, like a psychological thriller. And then I thought it was going one way, but it's just that, I think that's the best thing about this movie is that It went in a bunch of directions I wasn't really expecting, because like I said, it starts out like as a psychological horror or psychological thriller type film. And then it seems like it just gets more and more bonkers like it as it goes on until like by the end, it's pretty much a straight up horror movie. So it's an interesting experiment in like genre bending, I guess, if you want to say. It's not crazy, but it's like this does actually get more and more ludicrous like as it goes, and I don't mean that in a bad way. It's just like I said, it's just batshit insane. It just goes in batshit insane directions. So the story of Unsane is Claire Foy plays a young woman named Sawyer Valentini, and she's like a financial analyst or something like that. Now she has just moved, I think she was originally lived in Boston, and then she moved to somewhere in Pennsylvania. And she has kind of, she got a new job and everything like that. Now you find out as the movie goes on a bit, you find out that she moved away from Boston because she had a stalker. This stalker pretty much ruined her life, from the time she was a college student for 2 years. And so she has been forced to move. She's been forced to pretty much uproot her whole entire life. She can't have social media accounts, she can't have this, that, and the other thing, just because of this person's presence who wouldn't leave her alone. And not surprisingly, she has a lot of lingering trauma about that. So even though, like at the beginning of the movie, she's moved to a new city and has a new job, she still sees the dude everywhere. So she's kind of like having a lot of problems. They show her like picking up a dude in a bar, and then like she sees like the stalker's face on this guy, even though they don't look anything alike. And so she starts to feel like, well, maybe I need to talk to somebody. I need some counseling. So she just finds like a counseling center that's nearby that she can run over there, like on her work lunch hour or whatever, that she can, you know, so she can have somebody to talk to. And she tells them the same thing. She's like, you know, I had a stalker, and it's like, now I'm paranoid. It's like, you know, I can't go anywhere. I don't feel safe anywhere, and all this other stuff. Now, the woman, the counselor that she's talking to, basically asks her if she has any suicidal thoughts or anything. And, you know, Sawyer kind of says something like, yeah, but you know, a lot of people do. It's like, you know, in my situation. And they say, well, if you've thought about how you do it. And then she is kind of like specific about it, but the way she says it is almost kind of like offhand, like she's almost like joking. So you don't know how serious she is about it. But what ends up happening, because she says that, apparently this hospital that she has gone to just to talk to this counselor on her lunch break decides that they're basically going to commit her. Now, they give her, like, a contract to sign, and they said, oh, this is just a boilerplate contract, it's fine, you know, everybody signs this. But in signing it, she doesn't realize, because she doesn't really read it first, that she is consenting to involuntary, like, you know, to a commitment in this mental health facility for a period of 24 hours of observation. So basically they take her back, and she has to like take off her clothes, and they have to do examination, and they give her a hospital gown. And she's like, wait, you don't understand. She's like, I just came here to talk to a counselor. I'm not committing myself. I'm not, you know, I got to get back to work. She was just like on her lunch break or whatever. And they're like, yeah, but you signed this paper that said that you were, and you said that you had suicidal ideation and blah, blah, blah. So they basically involuntary commit her to a mental hospital, at least for a period of 24 hours. So as freaky as this is, because this kind of movie like freaks me out, because it seems like, I was watching another review of this too, and like one of the guys that was reviewing the movie, he said that this had actually happened like to a friend of his who had just gone to a counselor to like talk about some feelings and like made a joke about, you know, thinking about suicide or whatever. And they absolutely did like involuntarily commit him to a mental health facility for, you know, 24 hours. Because I think in Pennsylvania, I think the law is, and that's what it says in the movie, I'm not really entirely sure, maybe somebody from Pennsylvania can tell me, but that you can, you know, if you think that this person is a danger to themselves or others, you know, you can involuntarily like commit them to a mental for 24 hours of observation. And then subsequently, if they give you reason to think that there might be, you know, that they're still an ongoing danger, then I think 7 days, you can have them in there for 7 days. And after which point they have to get a court order. So she is understandably freaking out. They say, okay, you can have a phone call, and she calls the cops and says, you know, I'm being held here against my will. But then the lady behind the counter is just like, yeah, the cops get tons of those calls all the time, because it's like we always have the patients in the hospital like trying, oh, they committed me here, like come get me. She's like, the cops aren't coming. So, and then she, like, all the other patients in there are just kind of like not real happy about her either, and her kind of attitude is, that's kind of the scary thing about stories like this, is that the more you're trying to convince people that you're not crazy, that's like making you look crazier. And that's essentially what happens. And you can kind of understand like her frustration. You can understand her anger. And she's unwisely like lashing out at people because they've put her here against her will. She didn't know this was going to happen. But the more she does that, the more she looks like she actually does belong in there. So since she's there for 24 hours and she essentially assaults a guard, they're like, okay, well now you have to stay in here for the full 7 days. Now, when she's in there, she befriends another patient, and he has actually smuggled in a cell phone, so she's actually able to, you know, call her mom, and like her mom's played by Amy Irving, by the way. And so her mom like flies to Pennsylvania like to help her, you know, but there's not a lot she can do either because of how the law is. So at this point, this is like scary enough that this woman, that this could actually happen to you. You could just like walk in to talk to, you know, to talk to somebody about some feelings you were having, and then all of a sudden you're in a mental health ward like against your will, and that's scary enough. But then she's in a line, like getting the meds or whatever. And one of the nurses or guards or whoever, like one of the people that works there, is, or so she perceives, is her stalker. This was really interesting for me because this is the kind of thing, this is one of those movies where you're not really sure if Sawyer, the main character, is a reliable narrator or not. And I'm not really sure that that is ever resolved. It honestly could go either way. So, you know, it was she really like a nut and she just imagined all this shit? But yeah, it's that kind of thing. So she thinks this guy is her stalker. And he's going by a different name now. So obviously, like, the more she points out, hey, his name isn't, you know, whatever it is. I think it's like George Shaw or something like that. It's like, no, his name is David Strine. This is the guy that was stalking me back in Boston. He followed me here, you know, and got a job here because he knew I was here, blah, blah, blah. And obviously, like, the more she talks about that, the crazier she sounds, and the more paranoid she sounds. And so the longer she ends up kind of staying there. Now, from this point forward, I don't really want to spoil any more about it because, like I said, this movie, it's not that old. It came out in 2018. But yeah, it goes in some really interesting directions. As I said, it's almost kind of like the first part of it is like a psychological thriller type thing, which where the main horror comes from her being put in this hospital against her will and you, the viewer's frustration at, you know, at her maybe making some stupid decisions like the way she acts and like some of the stuff she says. But at the same time, you can understand, like, if you were in that situation, you'd probably be like freaking the fuck out too. At least I know I would be. But the more you do that, the more you say, I don't belong here, this, that, and the other thing, the more they think that you do belong there. So it's just kind of like this horrible like thing. So the first part of it is like the horror comes from that. But then once she sees who she perceives to be as her stalker, like working at this hospital, then it just kind of like ramps up. And then from that point, like I said, it almost becomes a straight up horror movie. This movie, it's like I said, it's kind of bonkers. One thing I will say, it's like, it's not, it's like some of the plot twists and stuff aren't super believable, but that didn't really bother me. I kind of feel like this movie, it seems like most of the critics I saw gave it real positive reviews. But there were a few that just like, that just really, really hated it and said it was just like trash or whatever. But I mean, I actually really dug it. As I said, it's not the most believable story and it's just batshit insane. Like it just goes more and more batshit like as time goes on. But I liked that about it. Like I liked how surprising it was. I liked that it took all these kind of twists and turns and I was just like, whoa, didn't see that coming. Didn't know it was gonna go that direction. And I think that's good. I wanna say it's kind of trashy, but it's not though. It's kind of like art house trashy. I don't know. It's like, it's really, really hard to explain. Now the fact that it was shot on the iPhone, I kind of feel like that maybe gave it a little something because I kind of feel like, well, some critics said it was, you know, it looks ugly or like the lighting looks flat or whatever. But I think that the fact that it was filmed with an iPhone, and I noticed that when I was watching reviews of it later, like after I found out that it was shot on the phone, they pointed out that at the beginning of the movie, Claire Foy's character, Sawyer, is like shot from far away, like almost like before you know that she had a stalker. So it's kind of like he did, like Steven Soderbergh did put a lot of thought into how he was gonna shoot this. And then as the story progresses and she gets locked up in this facility and starts losing her marbles, it starts kind of going like glitchy and like freaking out and everything. So it's almost like mirroring her mental state, I suppose. And you know, the state of like the craziness that's going on around her. So in that way, you know, did you have to shoot it on a phone? No, but he was experimenting. I mean, Steven Soderbergh, I think for, he made a bunch of movies and then like, he's like, fuck it, I don't want to make movies anymore. And like he retired, but then it seems like now that he's kind of gotten excited about filmmaking again, just like, and doing experimental type of things. Like he made, which I haven't seen this, but he made a movie a couple years back called Bubble. And I think that he used like all non-actors and things like that. So it seems like he's kind of gotten his mojo back, like, you know, experimenting with different types of filmmaking techniques. And that's like really, really cool. So, I mean, don't let the fact that this was shot on an iPhone dissuade you, because even though some critics say, yeah, it looked ugly or it didn't look cinematic or whatever, I did not even realize, like, when I was watching it, as I said, I just watched it on Amazon Prime because I'd heard some people recommending it. It didn't really, like, strike me that it was any uglier or weirder looking than any other movie. So, you know, it's like I said, maybe if you're, like, real into visuals and stuff, it's not, you know, super kosher, but, you know, I don't know. It didn't really bother me all that much. And like I said, it really did kind of, when you think about it, it did kind of, you know, feed into the theme of it or the narration. Like I said, especially as it's almost kind of like as the movie went on, he kept getting like closer and closer to her. So it's almost like at the beginning, he was like kind of shooting her from a distance as though he was the stalker and he was like watching her from far away, like from behind a tree and shit like that. So in that way, it did kind of all fit together. But yeah, if you really like psychological thrillers that are just nutso, then you will probably be really into this. I don't know. I was really into this. I liked this movie a lot. And it's, like I said, it seemed like most critics I saw really dug it. And it was actually pretty successful because I think it cost less than $2 million to make. And I think it ended up making $14 million back. So it was like a pretty successful, it was financially successful in that regard. And most people seem to really dig it. But I did see a couple of critics that really, really hated it. But I'm just saying that this is just kind of like a fun, crazy, twisted, batshit movie that goes in a lot of directions that you probably won't be expecting it to go in. And I actually really like that because I like a movie to surprise me. I didn't know which way it was going when I watched it. Like I said, it's horrifying enough that to think that you could just be like thrown in a mental health hospital or a facility and not be able to get out. And just the frustration of that is scary enough. And then add the whole stalker aspect into the mix. And it's just kind of like, and it just got crazier and crazier. But yeah, I really liked it. If you've seen it, as I said, it's on Amazon Prime. If you have Amazon Prime subscription, you can watch it for free. So if you've seen it, let me know what you thought about it in the comments, because I'm kind of interested to see everybody's take on this one, because it seems a little bit, I don't know if I'd call it divisive necessarily, but I can see how this might be like a either love it or hate it type of movie, like depending on your sort of attitude going into it. So let me know if you've seen it and what you thought about it, and we'll talk about it in the comments. And that will do it for this Flickers of Fear. I will see you guys on the next one. Bye.